Oh. seated.
They are age-old questions that rise up far too often these days. Questions we all ask, no matter what our faith tradition or our station in life. How can a good God allow bad things to happen? Where was God when evil slithered in and planted the horror that exploded our innocence? While someone this morning may have answers, I do not. But this is what I know. God is here, in the midst of this sacred gathering, in this sanctuary and beyond. Different faiths, different races, strangers bound first by loss and pain, but now clinging together in growing strength in a city that has always faced the darkness head on. We are members of one another, a community of resilience, hard pressed but not defeated, confounded but not consumed. We are gathered in community. And through the blur of each other's tears and the beats of so many broken hearts, we will rise in community and face whatever the future holds, resolutely as one. This is what is demanded of us, and this is who we are. God is here in our resilience. The grit that gets us back up again. And nothing taken will be forgotten or lost in vain. This is how God works. Good morning. I am Reverend Liz Walker from Roxbury Presbyterian Church, and I welcome you as we gather in community to help heal our beloved city and this violence-weary world. Let us pray. Creator God, in the beginning, you said, let there be light, and the light shone, piercing the darkness. Help us find our way through the darkness now. You taught us that we belong to each other. Help us hold each other now. We pray comfort for those who have lost loved ones, courage for those who are struggling through the trauma of physical and psychic pain, and tenderness to those for whom the world no longer makes sense. Lord, bless this broken-hearted city as she finds her balance, dusts herself off, and tilts her head back toward the sky. Open our eyes to your presence this morning. Open our hearts to your grace. Restore us so that we can see and be the light once again. In all that we hold holy, for me that is Jesus Christ, let the people of God together say, Amen.
High honor and privilege of representing the Greek Orthodox community of Boston and New England. Victory of Greece over the forces of an empire that devalued freedom, human dignity, and democracy. The Boston Marathon always coincides with Patriots Day, when we commemorate the battles of Lexington and Concord, the first of the American Revolution. Sadly, it was on Patriots Day, when we celebrate the values of freedom and democracy and the fiercely independent spirit of America, it was on that day that evil reared its ugly head once again, and countless innocent men, women, and children, and unspeakable act of brutality. But we know that bombs of terrorism may kill and injure, but they cannot crush the American spirit. Today we thank Cardinal O'Malley for opening the embrace of his cathedral to all of us, to President Obama, to Governor Patrick, to Mayor Bonino, to all who are in public service, to the religious leaders of the Commonwealth, to every citizen, regardless of creed. We gather as a community, as brothers and sisters in the household of God, to bow our heads in solemn prayer for the repose of the souls of three innocent victims whose lives were violently taken, and for the countless victims who will bear painful wounds for the rest of their lives. We come today to thank God for the police and firefighters, the National Guard, for the doctors and nurses, for all who responded selflessly and courageously. We pray that our gracious, loving, and compassionate, our merciful God, the healer of our souls and bodies, watch over us and comfort us in our hour of pain. And may he who is the Prince of Peace bring peace to our souls and to our community. And may Almighty God bless America.
We're here live at Boston Parish Radio and TV, and as you are hearing, we do not have the audio feed, but we have the audio feed of the service that's actually being held and in downtown Boston. Right now we have Tom Menino, who is preparing to speak, and we're going to go and listen to Mayor Tom Menino, and we'll come back and introduce ourselves and share more with you about what we're doing here at the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network.
Morning. And it's good morning, because we are together. We are one Boston. No adversity, no challenge, nothing can tear down the resilience in the heart of the city and its people. It is written that hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all sins. And since the clock struck that fateful hour, love has covered this resilient city. I have never loved it and its people more than I do today. We have never loved it and its people more than we do today. We love the brave ones who felt the blast and still raced to the smoke. With ringing in their ears, they tugged the gates to the ground
Answer cries, those in need. This was the courage of our city at work. We love the fathers and brothers who took shirts off their backs to stop the bleeding. The mothers and the sisters who cared for the injured. The neighbors and the business owners. The homeowners all across the city. They opened their doors and their hearts to the weary and the scared. They said, what mine is yours, we'll get through this together. This was the compassion of the city at work. We never love the heroes who wear the uniforms more than we do at this hour. Boston's finest in their blue. They carry kids to safety and calm the city crisis. The EMTs perform miracles the instant. The firefighters answer the call. We love the National Guard and our service members who brought valor to our streets. The volunteers in the BAA jackets and the vests. The doctors, the nurses, who waited their scrubs and did not buckle as the victims of the grave injured arrived. This was the strength of our city at work. We have never loved the people of the city, the world, our great country, more for their prayers and wishes. And yes, we even love New York City more. Sweet Caroline, playing at Yankee Stadium. Now the city's flag flying in lower Manhattan. It gives us even more strength to say prayer after prayer for the victims still recovering in the hospitals and home. It gives us the strength to say goodbye to the young boy with a big heart, Martin Richard. We pray for his sister and his mom, his brother and his dad. It helps us to say that we'll miss Christopher Campbell and celebrate his spirit that brought him to the marathon year after year. And it prepares us to mourn things he's moved, who came to the city in search of education and found new friends.
Let's introduce him. This is Pastor Bruce Waller. We're here live in the studio, and we're actually airing the memorial service honoring those who have been injured, the Boston Marathon.
And they will push us forward.
We're going to have the team that's actually here in the studio introduce themselves, and then we'll go back to Mayor Menino's speech. So we'll start with Minister Hobbs.
My name is Franklin Hobbs. Minister Franklin Wanda Hobbs. I'm Associate Minister here at Global Ministries Christian Church and the founder of Healing Our Land Incorporated Ministry.
Elder Thomas Cross of the Statewide Black Clergy, a senior advisor.
Again, Pastor Bruce Wall, senior pastor of Global Ministries and founder of Boston Praise Radio and TV.
And I'm Craig Ramsey, Jr., intern at Boston Praise Radio.
You're going to be hearing us throughout the service. There'll be others that will be calling in. And again, we want to just bring you some highlights and talk with you about our feelings and our impressions of what's happening today and what happened when Boston exploded. We're actually listening to some of the music. I'm going to go to Elder Cross and ask him to talk a little bit about, I mean, where were you when the bomb went off, and what were you feeling like when you found out that there was a bomb, two bombs set off at the Boston Marathon?
Well, I was home at that time at 3 o'clock. I had just got home from the Statewide Black Clergy's office, and my phone began to ring from out of state. My family calling me from Virginia, Georgia, wanted to know was I all right, was I down there? And I said to them, well, you know, I can't even hardly walk, so you know I wasn't down there. But it is upsetting to know that at any time in this city, in any place, that somebody could do something like that that would maim people in the way that they did.
You know, we at Boston Praise Radio on TV, we're beginning to, we're still feeling our way around as it relates to us covering events like this. And I had thought about maybe we should be at the Boston Marathon with our cameras and airing it live, but we just were not ready. We will be ready to cover those kinds of things. So we could have been there, Minister Hobbs.
Absolutely. And your question is with regard to how
were you feeling when you
when it happened? Interesting enough, I actually was coming into the studio, Pastor, while preparing for my broadcast, and likewise, Elder Crass, I got a phone call from Dallas, Texas, saying, "Are you okay?"
Right.
And I'm like, "What are you talking about?" And they're like, "There's an explosion." I said, "You're kidding." And I understood that. That's when I first learned that the explosion had happened. And so I came into the studio and then altered my broadcast to be able to incorporate what was happening. So I went to the news feed to find out. And then I got other phone calls from people across the country inquiring about my whereabouts. Okay. So we went to the feed. I brought the feed in that was on the air. So intermittent in my broadcast, I brought the live feed. But it was devastating. I mean, to see what was happening and to see what was going on downtown, to be able to see this was actually happening here in the city of Boston. People began to call in and so forth and begin to share their sentiment on Facebook, was blowing up, and so we started to share some of those sentiments, and it was just unbelievable. And so we began to pray, and that's what we began to continue to do, is just to pray. And that continued right from that point, right, quite candidly, up until this point, has been the focus on the coverage here at Boston Praise Radio, and giving the community an opportunity to be able to talk about their feelings, talk about their pain, talk about their fear. Mental health counselors, so, you know, we've had psychologists come onto the broadcast with all the facets of how do we address this, sustain beyond just these individual events.
Craig, what about you? Where were you? And
I was at school at Gordon College, actually having lunch with a friend, and it was one of the student commons, so there was a television there, and we had been watching Sports Center for most of the day. And one of the faculty and staff who actually works in the food rushed in. He was on his phone, and he said, "Do you mind if I turn the channel?" And we said, "Okay, well, that's fine." And we were wondering why, because, you know, we're sitting there looking at Kobe's Achilles tear and wondering the future of the Lakers. And he was like, "There was just a bombing in Boston." And we're like, it caught us so off guard. So we were like, okay, well, obviously that's a lot more important than what's going on SportsCenter. So when he turned the channel and they were just playing back, and it was a live feed of just the finish line, and it just looked like chaos. And, what happened is that, you know, on a college campus, social media is one of the greatest things ever introduced to a university, except, you know, probably the book. But it happened so fast, and you pulled out your smartphone and you just saw Twitter just go crazy. And it seemed like people just started crowding more and more around the television. It started with about three of us, and it was probably by the 20 minutes, there were probably about 50 people standing around one flat screen. And a lot of people were getting calls. I got a call from my family in Mississippi and my family in Milwaukee, and they were just like, "Well, what's going on? Are you there?" Because, you know, Gordon College actually did have school, but there were a lot of universities and high schools and public schools that were closed. So they just wanted to make sure that we weren't anywhere near, because the Boston Marathon, if you're not at school, usually you're expected to be somewhere in the Boston area for something that is such a momentous occasion. So it was one of those things where it was just so surreal, because you immediately thought back to September 11th. I was in fifth grade when September 11th happened, but I vividly do remember. There are some things that just kind of are burned into your memory. And one of the first things that I said as a fifth grader when I watched that, I was 10 years old. I said, this doesn't even look real. This looks like a movie. And so watching that again, it kind of brought back all those memories of just looking at that screen and saying, this looks like a movie. And I guess even on top of that is social media is also able to zoom pictures into you. And so you saw, I don't know if you saw the picture of the guy with no leg in the wheelchair, and that was just very graphic and things of that nature. So it was quite a sight. And I guess this is going to be another one of those situations that a couple years we'll definitely be able to remember.
Great. I actually, just like many of you, people were calling asking how I was doing. And I was actually in my automobile. My family and I, we were on our way to New York City. So, but all the way down to New York City, I listened on my phone, on my smartphone. I listened to the Boston stations because you couldn't pick them up in the car. And I just wanted to hear. I couldn't hear enough. I just wanted to hear more about what was happening. And Reverend Crass, as it relates to what happened there, there are a lot of people, a lot of us are comparing what happened at the marathon with what happens in our community every single day. Can we talk a little bit about that? And again, when we talk about this, other people are going to call in about this. This is not sour grapes, but it's a reality of what happened there, that one incident, and what's happening in our community. And we have some articles over there about that.
Well, every day we have this kind of carnage in our community.
Mm-hmm.
Our children are getting killed.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't help from wondering, where are the leaders at that particular time when our children are getting shot and killed and blew up every day? Where are they? And then watching television where everybody, the whole world, have come into Boston and been concerned about what's going on downtown and not what's going on in our community.
Mm-hmm.
It bothers me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it bothers me with a passion. And I pray for the victims and all that was hurt downtown at the marathon. But I'm hurt every day in this community. And I'm just wondering, I was saying to Pastor Walls this morning, what are they going to do? You know, what are they doing with all of their resources that they are raising? And no resources is put in our community to deal with this kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. $7.5 million have been raised already to assist the families of this tragedy. And I wonder, again, where some of these resources were when we were suffering and still are suffering the continued shooting of our families, our children. And again, as I said earlier, this is not sour grapes, but I'm just trying to compare this to what happened with the three deaths there at the Boston Homicide. And again, we are going to bring you back to the audio feed of the service as we are identifying, looking at different people who actually are speaking. Let's go and listen to this person who's coming to speak right now.
In the name of God, the most compassionate and most merciful, Mr. President, Governor Patrick, Mayor Menino, and fellow citizens of Boston, we are gathered together to mourn the loss of life in a criminal attack in our community. What happened on Monday has shocked and horrified us, but it has also brought us together. I come before you to share the message of my community scripture. I want to cite a Quranic passage that I studied when I was 7 years old. I was living at the time in Damascus, Syria. One afternoon while walking back home from school, I experienced the terror of a car bomb that exploded on my roof. I will never forget the sound of the blast, the confused rush of humanity, and the anger and the fear, these feelings returned on Monday. What gave me comfort at that time is something that may bring comfort to all of us today. It is a line from the Muslim Holy Scripture, from Surah Al-Maid. The passage declares that it is inspired by the Jewish tradition, by a decree to the children of Israel, that whoever kills a soul, it is as if he killed mankind entirely. And whoever saves a life, it is as if he saved all of mankind. On Boston Street on Monday afternoon, next to a great public library that bears amongst many names that of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, we saw souls murdered, but also lives saved. 1 week ago, I was at another ceremony here in Boston. I stood in Faneuil Hall with 400 other people before a bust of Frederick Douglass and John Adams. We came from 77 different countries and all kinds of religious backgrounds. I, the lonely immigrant from Mauritania, raised my hand and took with them our oath of citizenship. Those of you who are born Americans may not be aware of what naturalized citizens pledge upon officially joining the nation of the United States of America. I was profoundly struck by the words we recited. We pledged to defend the Constitution and the laws of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And we pledged to perform work of national importance under civilian direction when required by law. When I recited this pledge last week, I could not imagine that work of national importance by civilians would be required here in Boston so soon. But now, all of us need to take up this pledge. We all have service to perform, and indeed, we are all moved by the thousands of people who stepped forward in a moment of tragedy and confusion to serve. I want to salute everyone who ran towards the victim, despite risk to themselves. Everyone who gave blood, everyone who volunteered shelter for stranded runners. I want to salute the members of law enforcement who are protecting us as we speak, and to thank the people around the world who are sending messages of hope and solidarity. Before us, all is civilian work of national and even international interest. No one has to take a formal oath. We know instinctively that we must rise to the occasion and act because of our common humanity. That is what makes us Americans. One nation under God. And now a prayer. Dear God, Ya Rahman Ya Rahim, O Compassionate One, O Merciful One, welcome in heaven those innocent souls who were taken from us, and grant their surviving family members the strength to face their loss. Heal the wounds of those hurt last Monday, and heal the wounds of all Boston.
We're listening to prayers that are being offered by the various speakers that are coming to the podium right now. And we want to continue talking over some of the prayers and some of the speeches as we await the president's speech. We were talking a little bit earlier about the five people were shot in three attacks in Boston on Wednesday. You know, and it continues in our community.
And the thing about it wasn't even broadcast. We didn't know about it until this morning. I knew about the five shots in Boston. And it's a shame. The news media is covering all of that downtown, but they're not covering what's happening in our community.
Correct.
And to our children.
Amen. And you know, I was saying, in addition to the fact that they're not covering, I went downtown to Prudential Center. One, I went the evening I went down Mass Ave, and you couldn't even, within a 14 block radius, you couldn't even get to Boylston Street. I'm talking about, it was so dark, but you saw army trucks, you saw guns, you saw, I mean, people, just the presence, you know, of policemen. So every resource that we have is marshaled is downtown. So there's nothing in Dorchester.
Uh-oh. We're going to come back to that in a moment. Let's go to Pastor Miranda of the Lion of Judah Church. He's speaking right now. We're going to come back to that point.
It may manifest itself for a moment
but then it has to relinquish the field to a higher, nobler power who is in ultimate control. This is why we come together in a time like this as people of faith, to go beyond the immediate dimension of terror, death, and loss, and to elevate our eyes to that sacred sphere, to place this terrible tragedy in a higher context, in a brighter light that can redeem it and infuse it with elements of hope, love, and unity. If we could not gravitate to that dimension where infinite good sits on his throne, at this very moment, gazing lovingly upon this city, grieving for and with us and those who have literally lost life or limb, then perhaps evil would have achieved the victory that it sought so fruitlessly on Patriots' Day. But we are people of faith. We believe in a benevolent God who holds a steady hand over history, who even as he allows hatred and fanaticism to have its moment, has also declared time and time again through the many voices of millennial faith that in the end goodness will always prevail. That yes, weeping may stay for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Events such as the one that graced us on that bright Monday afternoon just a couple of days ago remind us that we inhabit a mysterious world where a loving, sovereign God sometimes allows a flash of dark energy to penetrate our domain, but only to ennoble us and to extract from us an even greater measure of good and generosity. The dilemma of evil is that even as it carries out its dark, sinister work, it always ends up sprinkling good and evoking even more strongly the very light that it so desperately tries to extinguish. We have all been inspired by the images and anecdotes of heroism and the just plain goodness that have already emerged from the first few hours of this unspeakable tragedy. This crucifixion has released much good. In our weakness, we have been made strong. In our suffering, we have been inspired to pray for others. In our woundedness, we have extended consolation. In our diversity, we have been united. In our perplexity, we have been led again to run to God and to remember that no matter how strong, fast, or successful we may be, we are ultimately children of eternity, able to find true hope and solace only in the bosom of our Father, in the realm of prayer and spiritual humility. In that paradox of weakness that we have entered into, we can become more gracious and more powerful, better channels for the grace of God to enter into this broken world. This is a small, immediate comfort, of course, to those who lie right now in a hospital bed, contemplating a life that has been irrevocably changed, or who grieve a lost or wounded loved one. We do pray, however, that they also may receive the grace to look beyond this moment of suffering and to believe that their life is far from over, that they can rise beyond their pain and their loss to become spiritually stronger and more agile, that they can find fullness of life and happiness and personal realization in the new normal that they now inhabit. May they never allow bitterness or hatred to linger more than a brief moment in their soul. May they receive that peace that passes all understanding. May they be able to translate into their own spiritual language the reassuring words of the Apostle Paul. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword. As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. God's love will yet have the last word. God has not forsaken Boston. God has not forsaken our nation. He merely weaves a beautiful, bright tapestry of goodness that includes a few dark strands. By faith, we will leave this sacred space today to continue that noble narrative of patriotism, self-sacrifice, and simple striving that was only briefly interrupted by impotent evil, but that now continues, richer, denser, and more poignant than ever. May our faith be strengthened, that we might leave from here with this conviction. God bless us all. Amen.
As you can see, we have a choir that's singing, and they sound pretty good. And when they started to sing, I didn't know if it was the choir from the church, but I knew it was the black sister that was singing, didn't I?
You did.
I'm like Reverend Cross. I can pick this up now. So again, Pastor Miranda had just spoken. We're waiting for Bishop. He's Bishop now. John Borders from Morningstar Baptist Church. Is that the title that he has now? Watch yourself.
Yes, he's Bishop John Borders.
And I was mentioning when I was talking that I know that the governor and the mayor have been at Bishop Borders' church for so many funerals and so many when they had the Mad Pen massacre, they called it. Mm-hmm. They utilized his church as a base for the police to be there, and so it'd be interesting to see what he says when he comes to the podium and speaks. But again, we were talking about the financial resources, all the money that's been raised for the families. Why is it that we cannot get that type of support and attention in our own neighborhood, in our own community? Anybody want to?
I mean, I think, you know, one of the reasons, quite candidly, unfortunately, I was speaking to Pastor Odom before I came onto the broadcast.
Who just a second, Reverend Borders. Let's go to him.
Of course.
To our mighty mayor, to all of you, Matthew chapter 5. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets before you." Beloved, I believe Jesus taught that to perceive the kingdom of heaven, you must see the opposite. When you see loss, see reward. When you hear a cry of pain, hear a prayer. When you see sacrifice, see a sacred offering. And to those of you who have suffered, in any type of suffering, wherever you might be, the Lord is saying to you, never lose sight of your future. You who mourn, you will be comforted. You who are broken, you will be healed. You who have suffered loss, you will be rewarded. The Massachusetts license plate says the spirit of America. And I pray the world right now, today, at this moment, will look at us and see the true spirit of America.
Dear brothers and sisters, dear friends, on behalf of our Catholic community, I wish to welcome all of you here.
I don't know. And that is a good point. So Cardinal O'Malley is preparing to speak. So the question is he actually preparing the eulogy, or is that really going to be the president who's bringing the eulogy?
No, I was just wondering, Bishop Borders, I thought that Bishop Borders was delivering the eulogy, but
because he was so short that I thought that Bishop Borders just basically he read the scripture and then he spoke. for just a few minutes to sort of wind that down. Mm-hmm. And it's it again, they were probably all given so many minutes to
Yes, he was given 3 minutes.
3 minutes to speak. How did you know that?
Because I spoke to his spiritual daughter, Pastor Laura Ahart, who made me aware that he was going to be the one of the speakers on the program.
Interesting. Well, again, we wanted to spend some time, continue to talk about the uniqueness of being a community radio station and being able to tap into some of these services around the country and to be able to speak about what's happening. And so, Minister Hobbs, then we'll go right around. What's your impression of what they're trying to do thus far? How have they achieved the goal yet?
I mean, I think their impression, I think what they're trying to do is really just give give some sense of diverse, of inclusive unity, and healing in the community. That's what they're trying to do.
Yeah. What do you think? What are they trying to achieve? Do you think they've achieved it yet?
No, I think they need to do a little bit more work before the service is over, before they achieve what they are trying to do. You know, I just don't see it just yet.
You have to pull these together so quickly, you know, and there's such a diverse group of men and women for many different religious and educational backgrounds. They're trying to pull together who to select, who to bring in. I was wondering if this service could have been held right here in Ashmont at the Episcopal Church, where I don't know how I've been in that church on some occasions, probably doesn't have the capacity, but that would have been an ideal place to try to do something, because I know that MSNBC actually was broadcasting right from Ashmont Station area all night the other night, talking about the family that was the family who lost their son and whose sister has had her leg amputated. And well, no, the capacity here is no significant. Yeah,
and the family belonged to St. Anne's Parish,
mm-hmm.
and you know. Could have been there in the day, the next day, so the community could have gathered outside while everybody was on the inside.
Right. Well, this is significant. I remember when Senator Kennedy died, they had his funeral at the church up on Mission Hill.
Mm-hmm. Mission Church.
Mission Church, and I know that in order to receive all the dignitaries, they actually repaired the area. They repaired the streets,
that?
The sidewalk.
Yeah, yes.
They cleaned the place out
because
they wanted people to come into a clean establishment.
Yes.
And many people in the other communities were saying, why couldn't you have had it here? We could have gotten our street repaired. And I don't know what they have done there to prepare for this event. But it's important for us, for those of us who are in the community, for us to talk about our impressions and about what we're feeling. And again, I'm trying to juxtaposition the tragedy of a family going to a marathon. And it's one of those things, when you wake up in the morning, you never know how your life can change 2 hours later or 3 hours later, that you've got to live ready,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? Like saying goodbye to people.
Yes.
And for people to experience a blast like that, the mind can't even catch up to what's happening to the body.
Mm-mm.
And then you finally wake up and say to yourself, I've been injured. I've been hurt.
Yes.
And it's almost, I liken it to the families that have had their sons and daughters killed on the streets of Boston, how those children leave during the day and they never come back, and the shock that they go through. And I'm trying to compare the resources that are given to the people in the community. I'm trying to compare the attention that people in the community receive over against what's happened here. Anybody want to step in?
I have 5 children and 15 grandchildren.
Mm.
I got 12 boys and 3 girls.
Okay.
And I can't imagine, you know, what would happen to me if my boys were downtown and even in the community here. Something would happen to, happen to them. They would get killed out there in the streets. But we live in a time where the enemy, and we that are spiritual know who the enemy is.
Yes.
You know, the enemy is wreaking havoc in our community.
Yes.
But the thing about it is, the people that can help, outside forces, is not helping us rid our community of that kind of thing. So we won't have to worry about that kind of thing.
Yes.
But when the people went downtown, they were sure was nothing going to happen to
that,
this.
That they were saved.
That they were saved.
Right. Yes.
They were saved.
Yes.
Expected to happen over here.
Yes. Right.
But it happened down there.
Yes.
Right.
So therefore, you know, and we in our community here.
Yes.
That's why we have to come together.
Yes.
And don't let nobody to divide us.
Amen. Amen.
You know, we're one family.
Yes.
And we got to make sure that don't nobody make us no big eyes and no little you.
Come on.
Yes, well, sir. That's why there are certain times years ago when I had my little heyday, I would be invited to different events, and sometimes I wouldn't go. I would recommend somebody else because I knew that it was in that person's jurisdiction or that person was better suited for it. And I wanted them to know that I said that I wouldn't do it, that you should do it as a way of keeping the unity, because I didn't want to cross over in somebody else's turf or make somebody else feel that because they thought I was the better person, that it diminishes them. And I think that that's how we maintain the unity. I remember that there was I can't remember the specific incident, but something major happened in our community, and they wanted me to speak because I was the clerk magistrate at the juvenile court, and I was a pastor. And I saw the faces of the clergy when my name was mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I had to go back to them and told them I couldn't do it because it was a conflict of interest on my job, I saw how the smiles came back on their faces. Mm-hmm. So we're going to be even careful when we are invited to different events.
Amen.
to be sensitive that we don't break the spirit of unity. Now, there's something going on the screen here. We're looking at our screen here in the studio, and CBS has a special report, and they're doing what we're doing while O'Malley is speaking. They've gone to the network. Have they gone to the network yet?
They're playing music.
Okay. See, they've actually gone to the network while he's speaking, which is the same thing that same we're thing. Doing. So let's continue to talk. Again, at Gordon College, what were people saying when this incident took place?
Well, I think one of the things is that a lot of it was surreal. There's a girl in the gospel choir who came up to me, and you know, and some of them look to me. I tell them to look to me as a big older brother, but I guess the transition it might be different aspects. So she came up to me, and she's from the Bahamas. All her family is in the Bahamas right now, and her parents had called her, and they didn't know what was going on. And she literally looked at me in the cafeteria, and she said, "Am I safe?" She said, am I safe right now?"
But she was saying, "Am I safe in?" Oh, they're showing West Texas. "Am I safe right in Gordon College in Wenham?"
Yes.
Wow.
And that's how much she didn't understand the distance and the severity of what was going on. She just really believed, like, okay, there's a bombing in Boston. We're kind of close to Boston. Am I safe? And I tell you, Pastor Wall, the way that she looked into my eyes, she was very afraid.
Yeah.
She was very afraid, and I told her, you know, what had happened and where it was, and so I told her, you know, you'll be okay. But you say things like that in the most confidence that you have, not in yourself, not in the government, but in Jesus Christ. Because I couldn't tell her based on, you know, the political system, whether she would be okay or not. And I guess that is the hope that we do have. But it's been a lot of prayer on the campus. A lot of classes have taken time to pray. And we've had a moment of silence. We've had a moment of silence this week. And our president he wrote us a letter and just telling us to just be very mindful and see any way you can help. Mostly, he said, you know, we're not always looking for money, but sometimes just be on your knees and pray, most of all. So
Did they take a moment of silence to pray for these five kids that was killed, shot here in Roxbury and Dorchester?
Well, I'm
probably... Did he do that?
No, sir. No, sir.
He did that. Now, I mean, see, that's where I'm hung up at.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody going to take a moment of silence to pray for what's going on down there. But what about here in our community?
Mm-hmm. You know, I appreciate what you're saying, Elder Cross. I mean, the reality is we have to do this, right? I mean, I think we put too much emphasis and dependency upon, I mean, it's great that the president is here, right? But the president is not going to be here tomorrow, Mm-hmm. Right. And all those resources, I mean, John Hancock is the one who actually is a large, I think he's the one that started the whole marathon. And so, you know, that he started off this fund with a, like, a, I don't know, a million, a big chunk of money. Up, Governor Patrick is getting ready, I guess, to come up.
Okay, we're going to go and listen to Governor Patrick, and we'll pick up on what they were saying, because I want to know how our church service needs to be different this Sunday than it normally is, as we focus not just on the Boston Marathon, but on the 5 shootings that have happened right in our neighborhood. Let's go listen to the governor, and I think the president should be coming after him.
Tradition, scripture teaches, in everything, give thanks. That isn't always easy to do. On Monday afternoon, I was not feeling what I felt, what so many of us felt then, was shock and confusion and anger. But the nature of faith, I think, is learning to return to the lessons even when they don't make sense, when they defy logic. And as I returned to those lessons this week, I found a few things to be thankful for. I'm thankful for the firefighters and police officers and EMTs who ran toward the blasts, not knowing whether the attack was over, and the volunteers and other civilians who ran to help right alongside. I'm thankful for the medical professionals, from the doctors and trauma nurses to the housekeeping staff, to the surgeon who finished the marathon and kept on running to his operating room, all of whom performed at their very best. I'm thankful for the agents from the FBI and the ATF, for the officers from the state police and Boston PD, for the soldiers from the National Guard and all other law enforcement personnel who both restored order and started the methodical work of piecing together what happened and who's responsible. I'm thankful for Mayor Menino, who started Monday morning frustrated he couldn't be at the finish line this time, as he always is, and then late that afternoon, checked himself out of the hospital to help this city, our city, face down this tragedy. I'm thankful for those who have given blood to the hospitals, money to the One Fund, and prayers and messages of consolation and encouragement from all over the world. I'm thankful for the presence and steadfast support of the President and First Lady, our many former governors who are here, I'm thankful for the other civic and political leaders who are here today, and for the many, many faith leaders who have ministered to us today and in the days since Monday. I'm thankful for the lives of Crystal and Ling Si and Little Martin, and for the lives of the families who survived them, and for the lives of all the people hurt, but who still woke up today with the hope of tomorrow. And I am thankful, maybe most especially, for the countless numbers of people in this proud city and this storied commonwealth who, in the aftermath of such senseless violence, let their first instinct be kindness. In a dark hour, so many of you showed so many of us that darkness cannot drive out darkness, as Dr. King said. Only light can do that. How very strange that the cowardice unleashed on us should come on Marathon Day, on Patriots Day, a day that marks both the unofficial end of our long winter hibernation and the first battle of the American Revolution. And just as we are taught at times like this not to lose touch with our spiritual faith, let us also not lose touch with our civic faith. Massachusetts invented America. And America America is not organized the way countries are usually organized. We're not organized around a common language or religion or even culture. We're organized around a handful of civic ideals. And we have defined those ideals over time and through struggle as equality, opportunity, freedom, and fair play. An attack on our civic ritual, like the marathon, especially on Patriots Day, is an attack on those values. And just as we cannot permit darkness and hate to triumph over our spiritual faith, so we must not permit darkness and hate to triumph over our civic faith. That cannot happen. So we will recover and repair. We will grieve our losses and heal. We will rise and we will endure. We will have accountability without vengeance, vigilance without fear. And we will remember, I hope and pray, long after the buzz of Boylston Street is back and the media has turned its attention elsewhere, that the grace this tragedy exposed is the best of who we are. Fellow citizens, I am honored. I am honored and humbled to welcome our friend, our leader, our commander-in-chief, the President of the United States.
Scripture tells us to run with endurance the race that is set before us. Run with endurance the race that is set before us. On Monday morning, the sun rose over Boston. Sunlight glistened off the State House dome, in the common, in the public garden, the spring was in bloom. On this Patriots Day, like so many before, fans jumped onto the tee to see the Sox at Fenway. In Hopkinton, runners laced up their shoes and set out on a 26.2-mile test of dedication and grit and the human spirit. And across this city, hundreds of thousands of Bostonians lined the streets to hand the runners cups of water and to cheer them on. It was a beautiful day to be in Boston. A day that explains why a poet once wrote that this town is not just a capital, not just a place. Boston, he said, is the perfect state of grace. And then, in an instant, the day's beauty was shattered. A celebration became a tragedy. And so we come together to pray and mourn and measure our loss. But we also come together today to to reclaim that state of grace, to reaffirm that the spirit of this city is undaunted, and the spirit of this country shall remain undimmed. To Governor Patrick, Mayor Menino, Cardinal O'Malley, and all the faith leaders who are here, Governors Romney, Swift, Weld, and Dukakis, members of Congress, and most of all, the people of Boston and the families who've lost a piece of your heart. We thank you for your leadership. We thank you for your courage. We thank you for your grace. I'm here today on behalf of the American people with a simple message. Every one of us has been touched by this attack on your beloved city. Every one of us stands with you. Because after all, it's our beloved city too. Boston may be your hometown, but we claim it too. It's one of America's iconic cities. It's one of the world's great cities. And one of the reasons the world knows Boston so well is that Boston opens its heart to the world. Over successive generations, you've welcomed again and again new arrivals to our shores. Immigrants who constantly reinvigorated this city and this commonwealth and our nation. Every fall, you welcome students from all across America and all across the globe. And every spring, you graduate them back into the world, the Boston diaspora that excels in every field of human endeavor. Year after year, you welcome the greatest talents in the arts and science, research. You welcome them to your concert halls and your hospitals and your laboratories to exchange ideas and insights that draw this world together. And every third Monday in April, you welcome people from all around the world to the hub for friendship and fellowship and healthy competition. A gathering of men and women of every race and every religion, every shape and every size. A multitude represented by all those flags that flew over the finish line. So whether folks come here to Boston for just a day, or they stay here for years, they leave with a piece of this town tucked firmly into their hearts. So Boston's your hometown, but we claim it a little bit too. I know this because there's a piece of Boston in me. You welcomed me as a young law student across the river. Welcome Michelle too. You welcomed me. You welcomed me during a convention when I was still a state senator and very few people could pronounce my name right. Like you, Michelle and I have walked these streets. Like you, we know these neighborhoods. And like you, in this moment of grief, we join you in saying, Boston, you're my home. For millions of us, what happened on Monday was personal. It's personal. Today our prayers are with the Campbell family of Medford. They're here today. Their daughter, Crystal, was always smiling. Those who knew her said that with her red hair and her freckles and her ever eager willingness to speak her mind, she was beautiful. Sometimes she'd be a little noisy, and everybody loved her for it. She would have turned 30 next month. As her mother said through her tears, this doesn't make any sense. Our prayers are with the Liu family of China, who sent their daughter, Lingzi, to BU so that she could experience all that this city has to offer. She was a 23-year-old student, far from home, and in the heartache of her family and friends on both sides of the Great Ocean, we're reminded of the humanity that we all share. Our prayers are with the Richard family of Dorchester. To Denise and their young daughter Jane, as they fight to recover. And our hearts are broken for 8-year-old Martin, with his big smile and bright eyes. His last hours were as perfect as an 8-year-old boy could hope for, with his family eating ice cream at a sporting event. And we're left with two enduring images of this little boy, forever smiling for his beloved Bruins and forever expressing a wish he made on a blue poster board. No more hurting people. Peace. No more hurting people. Peace. Our prayers are with the injured. So many wounded, some gravely. From their beds, some are surely watching us gather here today. And if you are, know this. As you begin this long journey of recovery, your city is with you. Your commonwealth is with you. Your country is with you. We will all be with you as you learn to stand and walk and, yes, run again. Of that, I have no doubt you will run again. Your resolve is the greatest rebuke to whoever committed this heinous act. If they sought to intimidate us, to terrorize us, to shake us from those values that devolve describe, the values that make us who we are as Americans, well, it should be pretty clear by now that they picked the wrong city to do it. Americans will lift up what's good. In the face of cruelty, we will choose compassion. In the face of those who would visit death upon innocence, we will choose to save and to comfort. and to hear, we'll choose friendship. We'll choose love. The scripture teaches us God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. And that's the spirit you've displayed in recent days. When doctors and nurses, police, firefighters, and EMTs, and guardsmen run towards explosions to treat the wounded, that's discipline. When exhausted runners, including our troops and veterans who never expected to see such carnage on the streets back home, become first responders themselves, tending to the injured, that's real power. When Bostonians carry victims in their arms, deliver water and blankets, line up to give blood, open their homes to total strangers, give them rides back to reunite with their families, that's love. That's the message we send to those who carry this out, to anyone who would do harm to our people. Yes, we will find you. And yes, you will face justice. We will find you, we will hold you accountable, but more than that, our fidelity to our way of life, to our free and open society, will only grow strong. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but one of power and love and self-discipline. Like Bill Ifrit, 78 years old, the runner in the orange tank top who we all saw get knocked down by the blast, we may be momentarily knocked off our feet. But we'll pick ourselves up. We'll keep going. We will finish the race. In the words of Dick Hoyt, who's pushed his disabled son, Rick, in 31 Boston marathons, we can't let something like this stop us. This doesn't stop us. And that's what you taught us, Boston. That's what you reminded us. To push on. To persevere. To not grow weary. To not get faint.
Come on, come on.
Even when it hurts. Even when our heart aches, we summon the strength that maybe we didn't even know we had, and we carry on. We finish the race. We finish the race. And we do that because of who we are. And we do that because we know that somewhere around the bend, a stranger has a cup of water. Around the bend, somebody's there to boost our spirits. On that toughest mile, just when we think that we've hit a wall, someone will be there to cheer us on and pick us up if we fall. We know that. That's why the perpetrators of such senseless violence, these small, stunted individuals who who would destroy instead of build and think somehow that makes them important. That's what they don't understand. Our faith in each other, our love for each other, our love for country, our common creed that cuts across whatever superficial differences there may be, that is our power. That's our strength. That's why a bomb can't beat us. That's why we don't hunker down. That's why we don't cower in fear. We carry on. We race. We strive. We build and we work and we love and we raise our kids to do the same, and we come together to celebrate life and to walk our cities and to cheer for our teams when the Sox and Celtics and Patriots or Bruins are champions again, to the chagrin of New York and Chicago fans. The crowds will gather and watch a parade go down Boylston Street. And this time next year, on the third Monday in April, the world will return to this great American city to run harder than ever. The sun will rise over Boston. Tomorrow the sun will rise over this country that we love. This special place. This state of grace. Scripture tells us to run with endurance the race that is set before us. As we do, may God hold close those who've been taken from us too soon. May He comfort their families. And may He continue to watch over these United States of America.
As we come to the conclusion of our prayer service this morning, just a reminder to everyone here in the cathedral to remain in their places until the President and Mrs. Obama have securely exited the building. I invite you to kindly stand now for our concluding blessing.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. May the Lord preserve your going forth and your coming in.
We heard. What did you say, Reverend Cross, about the president? About he's a preaching president. What did you say?
He's the best preaching president that we ever had.
Wow. You know, Governor Deval Patrick's message to Boston and the world, because they're on the world stage, was powerful. It's great listening to the president speak, because, you know, when we speak in our pulpits, our church is called Global Ministries Christian Church, and I'm trying to push the church to think, let's think globally. Mm-hmm. Even when we speak to a congregation in Dorchester, let's speak globally. And listening to the world leader, the president, again, he had a global perspective on his speech, but he was able to hone it and bring it right here. And he did. He sounded like a preacher. He's a president, but he sounded like a preacher.
He is a preacher. There's no doubt about it. You're, the old folks used to say, you're what you eat. Mm. And he sat in the church all of these years listening to one of the greatest preachers in the world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He had to walk away with something.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't just he had to walk away with something. He was in the church on Sunday morning.
Well, I know he doesn't have time to write all these speeches because I saw him yesterday at the press conference in the Rose Garden when he was talking about the defeat of the bill for background checks. That it went down a defeat because of what the Senate did. But so he had to have somebody write his speech. But I'm sure he added his own personality to it.
Of course,
he doesn't have time to.
As being a preacher. You write some. You take notes, but you ad lib, and that's what he was doing.
Right,
you know,
right.
That's exactly what he was doing.
Right,
you know?
Right, right.
He even shift gears.
Well, he talked about Boston. Now you were mentioning he talked about Boston. For example, Craig, you were talking about how the students at Gordon were asking a question: "Are we safe?" Because they know that Wenham and Boston. In their mind, they don't know how close it is, but they were concerned about being safe. Then you had the president talking about how he's walked the streets of Boston with his wife. What was the context of him walking the streets? You had talked a little bit about it when he was working for the Urban League and he volunteered.
Yeah, when he was as a lawyer, you know, a student lawyer, coming to Dorchester, probably Roxbury, you know, for him to have walked around in the city. But my thing about it, you go downtown and preach like that, but can't come over here and preach like that.
Come on.
Mm.
You know, Global Ministers wrote him a letter asking him to come to town.
Mm-hmm.
And his people said it wasn't safe for him to come to our community.
Mm. And then a couple weeks later, he showed up.
Oh,
down the street at the school.
At the school, a block away.
Right, and I saw the motorcade as it was going by the church with all the Secret Service and all the armed guys. And I said, "Wait a minute! Didn't the president just come down the street? Hey, get yourself back here!"
Yes.
I was gonna rush out to the street and stand in front of the motorcade and just stop. I was gonna stop it, but decided against that.
I don't know how that would have worked out.
Yeah, I'm glad you chose not to do that.
Yeah, Global Ministries might have had a new pastor.
Yeah, they would put you in jail. You know.
Yeah, they would have said, what is this mook doing?
Crazy preacher. Crazy preacher, you know. But the thing, we couldn't come over here. And that's what gets stuff like that bothering me.
Hmm.
You can come. Well, that's kind of a tragedy. But you can't come and say nothing to the black mothers and fathers that have lost their sons in the street, senseless.
Mm.
What do you say to them?
I'm so in agreement with you, Elder Cross. I mean, to be very candid, and I have to, you know, say this. I can say this in hindsight because we, as a bipartisan station, we, you know, obviously during the campaign, we couldn't endorse a candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But I actually worked on both of their on the president's campaign, and so I felt like his first term. And I'm in the barbershop, I'm in the streets, and I'm hearing people complain about what difference has it made to us? And quite candidly, I hear that honestly about the governor as well, and I defend both of them, saying that it's their first term and they're not just the governor or the mayor, the governor or the president of just black folks. But the reality is, in the president's second historic term, I'm really disappointed because I think this was an opportunity for him to be able to come here to the hood. If you're talking about building healing in our community, you're talking about we're one community, the rhetoric that's talking about we're one. Well, if we're really one, then why don't you come here? And really bring those resources that's going downtown to here into the inner city that can help us ongoing, not just reactive, to be able just to be responsive to this isolated event that's horrific.
Hmm.
You know, you said he's not just the president of black people. He don't act like he's our president at all. You know, I don't see nothing that he don't. We ain't got no jobs.
Hmm.
You know, we are the highest unemployed that it is. Is that right? Even in his second term, he only had one African-American appointed to his cabinet.
Mm.
One. And he was a holdover from the last administration. He can't find any.
Mm.
And I know some African-Americans that need jobs.
Mm.
You know, so we can find them for him if he can't.
You know, one of the things that I hear him saying, And, you know, back to the movement. I mean, we live in a democracy. Clearly, even this legislation that, unfortunately, during the State of the Union address, all the energy, all the unity around, you know, the solidarity around passing this legislation for background checks on the heels of what happened in Sandy Hook. And again, we have this tragedy that happens here all the time. But when it happened in Sandy Hook and, you know, all the people who were there, it seemed like there was a solidarity to be able to pass this legislation. But now when it really, the rubber met the road, it's filibuster now. So the bottom line, I guess what I'm really trying to say is I hear him saying that he needs us to mobilize, to organize, to push him to be able, because within the Senate and the House, there's that gridlock. And so the movement, you know, they're saying we need the people to be, just like the March on Washington, all the people that can bring back to the organizing, back to, he was a community organizer. So I think for us to be able to help him to be able to push and hold the, you know, the House, the Senate, all those folks to push stuff through that he can't do by himself.
Well, that's why he brought those families to Washington for them to lobby the Senate for to help them push through the legislation. But again, it didn't work. And as it relates to what happened on Boylston Street in downtown, again, the shock for the city, the shock for the nation, is that they expect it to happen in Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan. But when it happens in a place where they had cleared, where they said to the world, y'all are safe. Y'all can come here. Even you Africans, you know, can come here and take the race. It's safe. But they couldn't make it safe.
Yes.
And part of the problem is that if you haven't made Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan safe, you can't make downtown safe.
Absolutely.
It needs to be a safe city, not just safe for the tourists and guests that are coming in.
Absolutely.
Well, my wife says to me, sometimes when I'm talking to her, I said, baby, the president could cry when he went to Sandy Hook. Tears running down his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
But a 5-month-old baby shot to death in Chicago in the backseat of a car. Nobody says anything about that.
Come on. Yes, sir.
You know, something is
wrong. Something's
wrong.
Right, right. And I think until the nation, until all of us see a death, no matter where the death is, as one death too many.
Yes.
Until we all say that this should not be happening.
Yes.
And again, part of what's happening in our own neighborhoods, again, we have become paralyzed. Mm-hmm. Some of us have become paralyzed. I'm not paralyzed, but some people have become paralyzed, and they're in this survival mode. They have grown. People of color have grown to expect it to happen. I don't expect it to happen. And when it happens, we need to be speaking out against it, not just about what happened downtown, but we need to be speaking up about what's still happening in our neighborhood and community. And I still need to send that letter to the president again, inviting him back to our neighborhood to speak to us in our city about the hope that we also need to have that this can stop.
You definitely need to. And it's not a Republican thing or Democratic because both of them take us for granted.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Democrats said we're going to be that no matter what.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And the Republicans don't want us.
Right.
No matter what. You know, and we're caught between a rock and a hard place. So we have to do it on our own.
Amen.
Like Reverend Dickerson is going to have a prayer service on Monday night.
Okay.
At Greater Love.
To focus on this issue?
To focus on this issue. Okay. To focus, you know, to have prayer, to focus on this issue.
Because
sometimes even today, we are locked out. You know, we need to be able to come in and express our own way of moaning and groaning, you know.
And include it all.
That's right.
Because I think that if today, it would have been very strategic today if the president or the governor or the mayor had not just talked about what happened there, but had talked about lost lives in the city of Boston.
Absolutely.
You know, kids.
Absolutely.
And the families in the city of Boston. That would have been inclusive.
Yes.
Because it's not just about what happened downtown.
Yes.
It's really about what's happening to our children and our families in our country in every single city.
I totally agree, Pastor. And you know, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. stated, and I love this quote because it's so relevant. He said that the church, because it's up to us,
I've never heard that quote before. Could you?
You heard it before. He said that the church must be reminded that it's not the master or the servant of the state, but should be the conscience, the critic, and the guide of the state, and never its tool. And if the church does not recapture its prophetic zeal, it will become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority. And Matthew 16:18 says, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So I really believe them, and everybody loves to quote this, but I talked to Pastor Odom just before the broadcast, and this is the truth of the real answer. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If we, God's people, who will call by his name, would humble ourselves and do what? Pray. Pastor Cameron Wall challenged us on Sunday for a 30-day dare of prayer, seeking God. God, what am I doing? Everything that I can do, not being sold, not selling our community out because of perks that we can get for ourselves and for our agenda. And I think there are some folks who've done that in the city, in the state, and in the country. And so we've got to get to the place that we're saying, if I perish, I perish, but I'm going to see the King, and being willing to conceive and birth authentic ministry to manifest the part of the body of Christ that we are, to do what only we can do. She preached saying, do what you can do. When Nehemiah built the wall, the city was in ruins, but said, do what it is that you can do. And so each of us have to take that personal inventory. And for me, post what's happened on Monday has pushed me to another level. I was challenged on Sunday, and I took the dare. Mm-hmm. But I'm so glad that I did, because I had no idea that on Monday this was going to happen. Mm-hmm. And as a result of what's happened on Monday, it's just confirmation of the urgency for us, the people of God, the true church, the true called out that may never be included, as Jesus was not. He was rejected, but that's the chief stone that the church was built upon, that the gates of hell will not be able to prevail against.
If I might interject, I think one of the most important things that I've heard so far is hearing Pastor Wall talk about the expected and the unexpected. Now, I think one of the things that you have to notice is that when you get into that part of Boston, as Pastor Wall said, you don't expect things like that to happen. I think even going back to September 11th, you didn't expect anything like that to happen in that area. But I think one of the main points is that a lot of us have been desensitized just by the murders that we've experienced and that we've heard, to the point where it's so commonplace and it's so mundane now, if I could use those words, that it doesn't faze us anymore. But I think what happens is that since that happened at the finish line, there were a lot of people that have never seen a death, that have never seen murder like that. And so what happens is when you get people that aren't expecting that, and more people like yourself, Pastor Wall, you get a change in kind of the response. So now people are outraged and they are really pushing. Now the issue is, and not to be insensitive, that there are murders and deaths around the Boston area all the time. And sometimes we look at the paper and we look at the radio and we say, oh man, here we go again. Here it is again. It happened again. Another kid strayed. Another kid didn't. You know, and it's one of those things where it's become so formal to us, to where it doesn't seem like we're really making that push. Yes, there are people there. Please don't misquote what I'm saying, to the point where I think that nobody is trying to make a difference and nobody is caring. But in our community, it seems that this has become so normalized to us that it doesn't faze us. And so the amount of people that are pushing to not, it seems like sometimes your labor does seem like it is in vain, because of all the people that are kind of expecting it. No, not everyone is like that, but compare that to the finish line. There are a lot more people that were very much unexpected of what happened. And I think that is something that makes a big difference.
And I'm going to go back. We have a phone call.
We do, yes.
We have to go back to say, any murder in the Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan, any murder in these areas where we're experiencing such a high number of people dying, we have to speak out on each one of them and say that this will not happen in our neighborhood. Even if they point at you and say, there goes the troublemaker again.
Right.
He's always talking. But we have to do that, because if we don't, we do contribute to normalizing deaths and homicides. Let's go to the phone call.
Call you live on the air.
Peace. How y'all doing? This is Jamal calling.
Hey, Jamal, go ahead.
All right. You know, watching this, and since the events have unfolded since Monday, there's so much stuff going through my brain. Now, one thing I think for me, at least, is I often get accused of being the negative Nancy, right? Being the one who always got something bad to say.
You and I, not just you. We're in the same category.
I'm right there too.
Well, I was gonna
Reverend Crass, right, sitting right over there. Don't leave him out.
I was gonna say in a different category, though, only because I think that both of your Christianity prevents you from really hitting below the belt. where sometimes I will go somewhere that y'all would not necessarily go, right? Now, for this, as I'm watching this and I'm hearing all of these words from, you know, the elected officials, Duvall, Obama, it all sounds great. The preachers and the ministers and from all the different faiths, it all sounds great. But you know what I really realize is that all of this is just for show.
Yeah.
They're there because they have to be there.
Yeah.
People want to be there because there is a sick celebrity thing about this thing, which this is the place to be.
Yeah.
This is no different than a rock and roll concert on the Commons or whatever. People taking their cell phone pictures. So even the absorbing what the tragedy is, or what, and it's not so much a tragedy as it is a major media event. So we remember that as people here in Boston, we look at Obama and he says some nice stuff a couple of times. He makes you laugh, and you know, these are my streets. Me and Michelle, we, you know, we from here and all that. And people might be boasting to say, well, Obama's certainly going to help us out. Well, how'd that work out for Chicago? So my point is that even Chicago did not get onto the national map until they had to hit the ungodly number of 500.
That's crazy. 500.
For it to become sexy enough for people to take notice of. And then that had to be compounded with the fact of the girl coming to sing at the inauguration and then getting shot and killed a week or something later. You know, a mile and a half from the White House. So all of that made for good media. But now check it out. Ain't nobody talking about the 500 or the little girl now. It played out. So it lasted for a couple weeks, maybe a month or so. It was on CNN and everything. Now it's gone. Same thing with this marathon thing is about to happen.
Yeah.
And but the one thing that remains constant is the kids are dying in the street.
Mm-hmm.
And is it more tragic that someone got their leg blown off at the marathon or the kids get their heads blown off in the hood?
Mm-hmm.
And when we really compare whose boo-boo is bigger, right? It's supposed to be that senseless loss of life is senseless loss of life.
Mm-hmm.
And if we are able to prevent it, we should be able to prevent it.
Mm-hmm.
And we should work hard for that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's by somebody who has the sexy title of, you know, a towel head. Ooh, these Muslims, these terrorists, these, you know, from overseas, these boogeymen, these aliens from outer space, or whatever it is that drives the people and whips them into a frenzy because they've created this enemy, you know, this weird unknown secret enemy who just seeks to do everybody harm.
Mm.
But what are we going to do about the day-to-day stuff that is not so, you know, it's real regular. Now we're talking about 13 shootings in the city of Boston since the marathon happened, and nobody even has a mention of that?
Wow.
Mayor, commissioner included?
Wow. Right.
And the mayor did not call CNN out for saying it was a dark-skinned fella that they saw.
It took Reverend Al Sharpton to call him.
It took Reverend Al Sharpton to call him out on it. Because when they said it was a dark-skinned fella, my mind ran all the way back to the Stewart case.
Mm-hmm. Jamal, did you know that CNN said it was a dark-skinned
person? Of course. Yeah. And look, and don't think just because now they backed up off of it, don't think that they're not still looking for somebody.
Mm.
Okay? Mm. Because, of course, there has to be some sort of connection to whatever they wanted to connect to, ultimately. And there's a whole bunch of conspiracy theories out there in terms of da-da-da. You know, I tend to, you know, sit back because, you know, obviously we weren't able to do any investigation. We weren't able to get on the scene and you know, with our own eyes. So at this point, we're all just speculating off of what we're being told from the various sources. But the interesting thing, though, in just the larger picture of it, is just how some violences, or some acts of violence, let me use proper grammar, some acts of violence just garner more attention than others. And it doesn't even matter, like, okay, so it was a bomb. But right now we got, what, 3 people dead. It was like over, I don't know, 170-something people injured,
mm-hmm.
right? But if we have larger numbers over a longer span of time that does not seem to dissipate, it just continues to go on since I've been a teenager, these killings been happening, And it seems like nobody really cares or puts the same emphasis on this and that. And then we could talk about the devaluation of black and brown life, because like you was just talking about, oh, you don't expect it there. So something that pops off in Copley is more dramatic than something that happens in Grove Hall, Dudley, Mattapan Square, Fields Corner, Upham's Corner, Common Square.
Because they think that they're safe there.
Mm-hmm.
And again, with this happening in Boston, the tourists and everybody are going to recognize. Remember when I said to the tourists, do not come to Boston because it's not safe here, and people went crazy because they felt that I was messing with their income, with their money? But they are not safe here. And unless it's going to be safe for us, it's not going to be safe for anybody.
Right.
And that's the point that we need. That's the point that we need to drive home. It needs to be safe for all of us, not just for the guests and tourists that come to our city.
Right, right. And in an instance like this, even if we do everything that we know we can do to be responsible and whatnot,
mm-hmm.
you know, you can't account for crazy, mm-hmm. okay? So there's always going to be a certain element of the kook factor, where somebody's going to do something that you can't stop. But actually, I find it more disgusting that we have not taken action on that which we know is preventable.
Mm-hmm.
We know that if we put focus and attention in these areas, after school programming, mentoring, breaking down recidivism and reentry, anti-violence curriculum in schools, employment, so on and so forth. But we know that if we focus attention on those areas, it will have a direct impact, and yet we don't.
Mm-hmm.
And then overnight, folks say, we're going to create a fund, One Boston. Right? And now they got, seven and a half at the last count?
Well, at the beginning of the broadcast, it was 7.5. It's probably 9 point something now.
Right, exactly.
After the service.
Right, because mm-hmm. The service served as a telethon.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Mm-hmm. So this is the old school Jerry Lewis telethon. You got your cavalcade of stars who come on, right? All these different personalities.
You sound like Reverend Cross talking. Go ahead.
It's because it's real.
Yeah.
And for anybody who has, in the Bible, what is one of the things that we pray for to God? The power of discernment.
Mm.
And the people of God, we're supposed to be the ones who are able to see the hypocrisy, the contradictions, and call it out.
Mm. Yep.
Not sit idly by with it, not hold hands with it, not pray for it.
Come on.
We're supposed to be praying against that.
Yes, sir. Mm.
And be praying for clarity and all these types of things. And the healing that comes from this, like, this is just a feel-good moment, as we know. Obama's going to be gone, and in a couple of weeks, it'll be back to usual. Law enforcement will do what it's supposed to do to try to catch the culprit or culprits, and let's pray that they catch the actual guilty ones.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so on and so forth. But the bottom line is that for the people of Boston, bombs been going off in our hood every week.
Mm-hmm.
And so, unfortunately, the news for our community is, go back to business as usual. And in this sense, I don't mean, just not caring. I'm talking about going back to business as usual in terms of helping yourself, because ain't nobody coming to save us.
Mm. Yep. Mm. Good points. Jamal, thank you. Good points. Good points. Thank you
for
calling in. Appreciate that.
Yes, sir. Peace.
Okay. Bye-bye. Wow. Again, there aren't many people in our community who would say what you say, Reverend Cross, and there aren't publicly, and there aren't a whole lot of people in our community that would say publicly what Jamal Crawford is saying. But unless we hear this kind of insight, we're going to stay stuck as a city and as a community.
We need to wake up. I remember 1959, I think at Martin Luther King with Southern Christian Leadership Conference convention in Cincinnati, Ohio. He told us a story about Rip Van Winkle. And said Rip Van Winkle, when he went to sleep,
mm-hmm.
King George
mm-hmm.
was the ruler of England.
Yeah.
When he woke up 20 years later,
yeah.
George Washington was the president of the United States.
Mm-hmm.
He was not physically asleep, but he was mentally asleep.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's going on in our community.
Absolutely.
We are mentally asleep.
Mm-hmm.
And it's time for us to wake up
mm-hmm.
and deal with the big issues.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm hoping that Boston Praise Radio and TV could be one of those catalysts as we continue to purchase more time on the AM, the satellite, and all the other venues that we have, that will be a catalyst that we as a Christian radio station will say the things that other Christian radio stations will not say because they're so busy trying to deal with the national national speakers, national broadcasters. We've got to say the things that need to be said if we're going to be a watchman on the wall. We've got to herald the good news, and we have to share the truth about what's happening in our city and also in our neighborhood. Again, we have a vehicle, and we've got to utilize this vehicle. And we may alienate some people by speaking the truth in love, but we need to speak the truth in love. And I find that Minister Hobbs, when he's on the air, he has a lot of people that are tuning in because he does not sugarcoat what he has to say, whether it's late at night. One story is told of Minister Hobbs when he first came to the station. He was broadcasting at about 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. And somebody had called him, and they were getting into... It was a conversation that was like an adult conversation. So I called in to Minister Hobbs. I said, Mr. Hobbs, I said, you can't be having this kind of a conversation on the radio. He says, it's 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. All the kids are sleeping. I said, Minister Hobbs, we are worldwide. So it may be 12 midnight here, but it's 12 noon in some other country.
Right.
But I have taken also those restrictions off because people need to hear some of the things that we talk about. And the truth is the truth, and it needs to go out. And so we're going to do that here at Boston Praise Radio and TV. And I hope that people will get used to us. I hope that people say, let's turn to Boston Praise Radio and TV, because they'll at least tell us. People around the country, let's tune into them because they'll tell us the truth. We got about we got 5 minutes to go, and we have to go to a paid program. Reverend Frank Murray is coming out at 1 o'clock. We can't take his time. Anybody else? Any final comments?
Well, the only final comments that I have now is getting back to the statewide black clergy. We have children and babies, and that's what we look out for. That's what the statewide black clergy is all about. Everything that we do is about our babies.
Okay.
About our children, and bringing them together. And I'm saying to you, this, I just want to add this in. Anybody out there that have any old used instruments, we're trying to create a historic black college marching band here in Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
So if anybody have any old instrument reeds, brass instruments, drums, bring them to the statewide black clergy, which is 185 Roxbury Street. Phone number 617-445-3336. If you call, if you can't bring it, we will pick it up. Be more than glad to pick it up.
And what about the prayer meeting
on Monday? Reverend Dickinson at the Greater Love Tabernacle will be having a prayer service for today.
And he's doing that as a church, inviting the community in.
As a church, inviting the community in.
Good thought.
Also want to say, Pastor, with regard...
Just a second, the time? Did you mention the time?
It's 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock.
No,
our producer. Thank you, producer.
With regard to, practical steps that is sustained, because I think we're so reactionary. When things happen, we have these kind of things. And as Jamal said, we go back, and it's always reactionary. Mm-hmm. And we need to have a sustained movement. The gun conference that we had was outstanding. 7 days. Never has that happened before, that the church led a conference for 7 days and brought in various voices and has it continuing to air. So one of the things that we're working on with Pastor Bruce Wall here at Club of Ministries Christian Church with Healing Our Land, and we're soliciting everybody and anybody to help us. We want to have an unprecedented faith-based state of emergency healing and empowering movement conference that will culminate with a community march and rally that will have resources for us then to be able to implement collective programs, because we have to build infrastructure in a movement that is not about an organization, not about an entity, not about a person, but about a movement. I heard someone say, no movement is a success without successors. So someone who's willing to, we got to train another generation. Mm-hmm. He said he called the old because they're wise and the young because they're strong. Old men would have dreams, young men would have visions, but there's a disconnect, And I see, and so one of the things we're doing in this conference is we're talking about a youth, a peer-to-peer kind of a thing, but really with the emphasis on young people, that we can pour all this wisdom and connect the two, turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children. Mm-hmm. And so we're doing a conference. We're planning on doing that maybe July here in the city of Boston. And anybody who's interested in helping us to plan and shape, because we want you to be a part of the planning and the implementation of this sustained movement that's a state of emergency, faith-based, healing and empowering movement.
Well, you made one statement, and I'm going to be through after this. It just ran across my mind. You said President Obama wanted us to make him do something.
Okay.
Then I think we need to make him do something.
Excellent.
Not just give us lip service.
Amen.
Pat us on our hand.
Amen.
Pat us on our head and make us think that we're happy when we're not. Mm. I think we should do something. I don't know how we're going to do it, but I think we should get together and make him do it.
I agree with the question. I would say not just President Obama, but also whoever will be our next mayor. Mm-hmm. We need to vet them to make sure that they're going to do something for that. We're one city that's not just downtown, but that Dorchester, Roxbury, Mattapan, as well as the governor, the city and the state. And the government, we got to hold them all accountable and ourselves accountable to hold them accountable.
I think something that's very important that if I might just add, just as a young person and just seeing, not being where you all were in experience, but I think taking from your experiences, if there's one thing that I've learned today and just hearing everything that was said and the emotions that were here, is that the Bible says it very simply, is that some men trust in horses. And some men trust in chariots,
yes.
But we will remember the name of the Lord our God. And so it's one of those things where I'm learning not to get so strung up on people because the government's not going to make the change.
That's right.
The president's not going to make the change. We can talk about that until the cows come in. It doesn't matter. It seems like we say the same thing about every president. It just seems that it hurts even more because the president is kind of the same tone and skin color as us. But the bottom line is that if you don't put your confidence in the Lord our God,
then
it's always going to come out with an L, and you're always going to feel like somebody has failed you. I'm not taking light of any situations, but it's just something that I've seen and what I've heard is that if you don't build your hopes on things eternal and hold on to his unchanging hand, we're going to keep having this conversation. So I've learned as a young person not to be cynical and not to be very analytical of the situation and understanding that I do need to be practical in what we're saying and what everything that's going on is good.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, if Jesus is not the center, you know, the song says, from the heart to the heaven, Jesus, you be the center. Mm-hmm. If he's not the center, we can talk about if he's not the center of the White House, then it doesn't matter. We just need to make sure that he's the center of your house. So I'm just kind of... I'm encouraged because I hear what's going on, but I'm encouraged because this is what separates us from the unbelievers, that at the end of the day, we still have hope, and we still see the light at the end of the tunnel. So I just wanted to add that. So I'm really encouraged about the great men that are in this room and the things that I'm learning just being 22 years old and seeing that the future is brighter than it was yesterday and that we're moving towards something a little bit better. And if we always talk about our days getting better than before, that means yesterday is a little bit worse. So I'm excited to see where everything's going to go. Understanding that God is still the center and he still reigns supreme.
And I'm glad that you're around the table.
Amen.
Being a younger person around the table because, again, you're being exposed to our collective years of experience, but we're being exposed to you and to your generation and to what they're thinking. So it's a collective of learning from
Thank
each
you.
Other. We have about a minute to go, so let's close out in prayer. Let's ask the young one to pray us out and thank God that we could broadcast that we can broadcast on the same medium that the major medium is broadcasting on. Let's thank God for the we're catching up to the main medium and we're going to go past them. Go ahead.
Okay. Lord, we just thank you for just being here. We thank you for being in our conversation.
Yes.
Lord, we ask that you continue to be in our hearts, continue to be not just in this city, but even continue to hold the world in your unchanging hand. We ask that you would be who you said you are, Lord, and continue to do that which you said you would do. Lord, we ask a special blessing on our guests and that you would all keep not just us, but this city and our world healthy and safe and comfortable, but not comfortable to the point where we're not making change. Lord, help things that need to be changed, and above all things, just be present because we know where you are, no wrong can be. So we thank you for all things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's go back. Shine.
The expressions and opinions that are on this next broadcast are not necessarily those of the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. We're going to our next broadcast, Reverend Frank Murray.
Holiness, it's what I long for. Holiness, it's what I need. Holiness, holiness, it's what you want for me.
Reverend Murray is the senior pastor of the Bethel Baptist Church, and they're located at 18 St. James Street in Roxbury, Massachusetts. 18 St. James Street in Roxbury, Massachusetts. If you want to call them, you can reach them at 617-445-0584. And now, the Reverend Frank Murray.